I'm going to be honest for a second and say that I've definitely reached a point where everything in grad school right now seems overwhelming. I think I was fine last semester and there were a few stressful moments, but this semester I've really hit a point where I suddenly feel very inadequate, which I guess is what imposter syndrome is. But suddenly it's like I'm questioning all of my skills and whether I can do it. And I'm saying all of this not to raise pity or kind of get any comments around it. I'm just sharing it just to be honest about how it feels when you're expected to do so much intellectually and you're pushed on purpose to the limits of your bounds in order to grow as a researcher and as a scholar and as a writer. And growth only happens when you're uncomfortable. And right now I am very uncomfortable. Our dissertation proposals are due very soon. We have a literature review that's due extremely soon. And it just suddenly feels like I'm floundering and everything. And I'm trying to make sure that I have like the proper frameworks for how I'm writing my papers. But suddenly I don't feel as confident as I did before, and it kind of feels like I'm scraping by in all of the tasks that are put my way because of the sheer amount of things that are expected and also the level of quality that is expected from me. Given how chaotic everything has been feeling, I'm very excited to share with you the sponsor of this video, which is Scrintal. They are a note-taking and writing platform that I have now been using for a bit within my own research work, and it's really helped me a lot, so I'm excited to share it with you. If you want to subscribe, you can find my discount code below with Christina10 for your first subscription. The reason why I have found it really helpful is because before, like when I was in high school, I was actually a huge mental map person. So all of the notes that I would take, I would then initially I would write them in bullet point lists and then I'd actually make mental maps. And that's how I found I would study for exams and I found it the best way to think through ideas and analysis. And currently I'm not really studying for exams anymore. That's not really part of my degree as much right now. It's mostly just papers and my own research. And I'm currently starting my dissertation work, which has just been, it's huge. It's a lot of, the thing is, it's like a lot of moving pieces that I'm putting together. And it's one of the largest research projects I've ever worked on in my life. And because of that, my initial way of taking notes, which by the way, is just a massive Word document with just a running list of notes nonstop with no real organization to them, is unmanageable. And so I've been using the Scrintal platform and it's actually been really helpful because I, again, can make the mental maps that I once did when I was in high school. I've been creating them in thinking about the papers that I've been writing. And I found this really helpful because it also allows me to see the connections within my research as I'm working on a few different papers right now. And also I really like the visual aspect of my research and being able to think through my ideas a bit more than just like in my head, they're all connecting somehow, but I can't see it happen. And sometimes I can't even see it happen in the paper. And so I've found it extremely helpful as I'm fleshing out all of my like papers and research to have a place to have it visually all there. And I think like at times I have paper written notes in my notebook, but I mean, honestly, everything is on my computer. And so I urge you, if you like me or are also like a visual thinker, to use the try out the Scrintal platform. Tell me your thoughts. I think it's actually like a huge plus for a lot of researchers who really want to be able to like see what their ideas look like. And when like a bullet point list just doesn't cut it.
I started off the week by going to the New York Public Library to do research for the first time ever at their archives. So the New York Public Library has a huge archive collection of various documents, letters, manuscripts of extremely famous people, authors, politicians. They have company records. Honestly, I've actually been quite shocked at just how many archives exist there.
I'd come here actually quite often before to like study and write, but I've never used it as a research facility. Also, a lot of tourists come just because it's like a stunning place to be in. And it was so exciting to be here for the first time ever, like on an official quote unquote research visit. So you have to make a appointment on their website. And I actually recommend doing this quite ahead because it takes a while for them to pull up the archives that you need. Normally also, when I first came in, it took a lot for me to set up. So this was my first time coming into setup, and I actually couldn't access everything I requested just because I had to like make sure that it created the account and everything. And here I'm looking at a microfilm. So they were able to give me the archive on this microfilm, which is basically like this tape reader where you can see scans of the images that you're analyzing. And it took me a bit to actually learn how to use this microfilm reader because it's a little bit like old techie, but the librarian was extremely helpful. She helped me set it all up, and also like she helped me how to screenshot all of the images so that I could then email them to myself. This is the microfilm at work. So as you can see, it just kind of rolls through the tape, and I just like click through the images and see what I need or don't need for my research. And the images that I needed, I ended up just screenshotting, emailing that to myself at the end of the day. And I also had to learn how to like put it back together. And then you just give the whatever archive you were looking at, in this case, the microfilm, back to the archivist. And then you can just go back home. There's a few like adequate rules of adequacy, I guess, you need to like know. Like you can't have pens in there so that you don't write on the materials. You also like can't have any water or beverages in there. So you have to like make sure that you put it all away. But I really loved it as the first experience. I'd recommend anyone who's in New York to come here just as a first trip, because it was actually not as daunting as I thought it was going to be. And it's just like an extremely stunning place to be doing work and feeling like what you're doing is actually important in the heart of Manhattan. And I was quite tired after this research day. I ended up coming home and crashing, and I couldn't actually even do that much work at the end of the day. But it was overall very successful. I'm about to have class and there's a lot happening. I feel like right now I'm at the point of the semester where it's just like go, go, go. And I'm so flooded with work, and it feels like it's basically not going to end until the final season. And I remember like when I started off this semester, I was feeling very positive. I was like, I'm going to manage my time well. I'm going to be extremely on top of my readings. And the first like 2 or 3 weeks, I kept up with that feeling. I was like, things are good. This is the semester. And now I think that was a bit of a delusional dream that I was in that first month of when things didn't actually ramp up. This week I have 2 presentations. And they shouldn't be too bad. One of them is actually, I'm actually interviewing the author of the book that we read and asking her about her research process and writing process. So that's really not that bad. Once I'm finished with those presentations, I then have a few papers that are like my midterm papers that are starting to get due. And also the main thing is that we have to write our literature review for our proposed dissertation topic. And I still feel like a mess for that. My brain is not fully there. It's due in like 3 weeks, and I still have not gotten all like the theories and done all of the background secondary sources reading that I need to do. So a lot of things need to get done, but that's just grad school. That's just life. I wanted to quickly mention actually 2 books that I got from the publisher in the mail, both that look like fascinating nonfiction. The first one is Pure Wit: The Revolutionary Life of Margaret Cavendish. If you have been on this channel before and have heard me talk about the book How to Think Like a Woman by Bregan Penaluna, I read that last year. It was one of my favorite books from last year. It was one of my favorite nonfiction books I've read in a very long time about female philosophers. A lot of them were from the 17th century. And Margaret Cavendish was actually one of the women that she had included in her book. And Francesca Peacock came out with a new biography of her, which seems fascinating. She was born in 1623 to a wealthy family,
And then in 1644, and as England descended into civil war, she joined the court of the formidable Queen Henrietta Maria Oxford before following the queen into exile in France. And then she became a writer. She wrote extensively on gender, science, philosophy, and published under her own name at a time when women rarely did so. And her biggest work was The Blazing World, which was a utopian proto-novel. So I am fascinated. I want to read more about Margaret Cavendish after having read a bit about her and Regan Penaluna's work. And I kind of think more people should know about this biography. The other book that I was sent over is Nothing Ever Just Disappears, Seven Hidden Queer Histories by Dharmood Hester. And this one talks about the worlds of James Baldwin, Josephine Baker, E.M. Forster, and other creatives. It says that from the suffragettes in London and James Baldwin's home in Provence to Kevin Killian's San Francisco and Derek Jerriman's cottage in Kent, Nothing Ever Disappears, a celebration of freedom, survival, and the hidden places of the imagination. It sounds fascinating. I am interested in a lot of these authors and their personal lives too. That's kind of my favorite, like, I don't know, intersection of nonfiction to read, like personal and professional lives, especially when it comes to like artists and authors. So I'm extremely excited to read this. They also, there's like some photos. This is Josephine Baker. And I think it's also another fabulous nonfiction that came out. As I said, both I have not read, but I want to read once I stop feeling flooded by this semester's work. Now I have to rush to class, and I will check in with you later as I hopefully get through the work week. Friday. It's been the longest week ever, and I'm just happy it's wrapping up. I have one class today in which we're actually going to be discussing the process of us writing a literature review, which is what has been freaking me out this whole week. But I think organizing my thoughts using the Scrintal platform actually really helped me, because I'm not an outline person, but I think for once I have so many things that I have to include within this literature review that I need some form of organization that isn't just a running document of all of my bullet points just in one. This week I also had two huge presentations that I had to give. One of them was I had to co-present with a person a book that we were reading for the class and kind of like give the class a quick summary of the book, a little blurb about the author and the history of what we were studying, and like lead the class in discussion, which I think went well. I don't know. We had a discussion. I think it went fine. There's nothing else to say. And then my second presentation, I actually had to, for my class, interview the author of the book that we read and ask her about her writing process and also lead her in a discussion. And then we opened it up for the rest of the class for a further Q&A. That was really fun. I think that went well too. I don't know. Presentations, I feel like, are one of those things where you just kind of like do them, and you never really know if you did well or not. Sometimes half of the people are like not even listening to you anyway, so it doesn't really matter. And the stakes feel both low and high all at the same time. For me, it's just a huge relief that they're finished and I can now think about all of the papers that I have due, mainly this literature review. So I'm gonna be honest, when I first started off this week, I panicked a lot about it and I felt like I had gotten nowhere with my work. Like, I just was like, I don't know what I'm doing. I feel like I have no conception of how to do this research and not enough to say in this literature review, where you basically are expected to say what other academics have said on the topic and how you're going to say something different. But I have spent the past week each day doing a bit of reading, even if it was just an article that would be applicable to the literature review. And I think after a week of doing that, I feel so much better. I like wrote down a lot of notes. I actually have a better understanding of what historiography I'm writing from and feel like I'm not just starting from a blank slate, and I know, hopefully, which perspective I'll be saying that I'll be arguing from. I don't know. We'll see how it actually ends up happening, but I'm feeling overall a little bit better. I still have to, the midterm season is like right here basically, and it's just kind of crazy how fast the spring semester has been. It feels like it's way shorter than the fall semester, which felt like it dragged on for a really long time. And I already feel like as if I'm like about to end my year at Columbia already now, even though I still have like 2 months left, 2 months-ish left. And it feels like it's about to end already, which is really sad. I'm trying not to think about that. And I still have a lot of like research planned for the summer, which I'll be sharing, as I'll be doing a lot of like research trips and archival trips. But the year at Columbia is coming up to a quick close very soon. The one other book that I wanted to mention and share is this book that is published by one of my favorite publishers, Persephone Books. They're a UK-based publisher and they've published a lot of like forgotten female authors, specifically from the 20th century. I recommend looking at their website. Their books are quite expensive, especially if you order from the US, just because of like shipping and producing each book is kind of pricey since they're an independent publisher, but they're worth every penny. And this one specifically is London War Notes by Molly Panther Downs. So I didn't know this because this came up in my research and I came across her again and I was like, wait, I have her book on my bookshelf. She had actually written for the New Yorker. She wrote for the New Yorker 852 pieces from 1938 to 1984. For almost like 50 years, she wrote for them. Their letters from her letters from London. And she specifically reported and wrote from the UK at the start. She started writing, I think, at the start of the war. And this is her full diaries of living in the UK and her experience of World War II, which is fascinating. And I started reading her this morning and she's an amazing writer. I think it's just so impressive that there are so many, especially like female authors, that were writing so much in like the 19th, 20th century. And so many of them we don't really know now. And like if it wasn't for publishers like Persephone Books, we would just never come across their work and like completely forget them. So that's why publishers such as this are really, I hold dearly and closely to my heart, and I will read anything that they publish because sometimes I really crave the like more contemporary novels and writing, and that feels like it's more of the day that I'm living in. But in other times, I just want to be immersed in amazing writing and feel like I'm in a different, and feel like I'm in a different time. And I've actually tried to read historical fiction, but I don't think historical fiction fully is my thing because I'd much rather just read a book from a person from that time rather than historical fiction. Although I do think historical fiction offers a lot of interesting avenues to write about lives that may have not written, they don't have any written record. And so that is interesting from that perspective. But overall, I don't read that much historical fiction in my free time. I hope you enjoyed tagging along with me in this weird, crazy week at Columbia that I've had, full of research, freaking out about my literature review. If you did, please like and subscribe to stay tuned for more. And I will see you in the next video. Bye.